that the cinema offered a liberation from the terror of writing.
Ainsi, dans le temps des fables, après les inondations et les déluges, il sortit de la terre des hommes armés qui s'exterminèrent.
The cinema offers a place or a territory, a world with no history, but one that spends all its time telling stories. And in this film, Notre Musique, he presents what he calls an acoustic image of that militarized world of an elastic geography that Eisman speaks about. And this acoustic image is sort of like this eternal event. And I want to talk about the movement of this elastic geography. I want to get into the actual kind of details of how that operates using a Deleuzean framework. So in comparison to the vernacular realities of war zones, to consider the aesthetic aspects of war via their manifestation on screens, like the cinema, like television, and even in computer games, this may appear to be, an event that's or an activity that can be in part consciousness-raising in the concept of agitprop, but it can also be sort of the pursuit of privilege, I think, economic embellishment. What is the place that we hold as academics and as writers and as filmmakers? What is this place that just repeatedly tells the same stories of torture, mutilation, and death of another? And how do we make sense of this kind of episodic territories that continually repeat the same things over and over again, violence and perpetual conflict? I guess this is a question that Deleuze asks when he thinks about how is thought engendered and how do we overcome the difficulties in thinking difference. The sign of point of departure for that which forces thought is thus the coexistence of contraries, he says, the coexistence of more or less an unlimited qualitative becoming. And the intensity of the effects of the sensible, organizing registers of a number of different illusory aspects of consciousness tend to operate as social praxis. And these are the things that produce thought effects. They're illusions that are delusions of being. Consciousness, according to Deleuze, exists in the transitive passages from one function of being to another. And it's these transitive vectors that we find the events, such as the war event, forming and unforming places for stories, for storytelling, and for writing. And Deleuze's philosophy in the end, I think, describes how an event is agency itself. To make a war event contains within it the already imminent attribution of such worlds of militarism that Godard films here. Now, as the modalities of militarism shift and change over cultural time and locations, so do the perpetual senses of what a community is. The technologies of militarism locate specific communities in time. For example, the perceptual ground of war from the time of the declaration of the State of Israel was altered in the transversal tactics of the deployment and possession via herbicide engaged by the Israeli Defense Force, as Etienne's told us, against the Palestinian people. And in that corporeal transformation of body into munitions by suicidal detonation by a Palestinian intifada against the Israelis, the first seems to be a reconfiguration of the notion of how boundaries, physical boundaries, operate through the instigation of asymmetric waves of destruction and nationally imbued deeds. The second, the activity of shaking off an oppressive force by setting off aleatory tremors designed to undermine stabilities. Both tactics engage effective means to disturb and displace the communal bodies of their opponents, as designated by the controlling forces of ethno-political programs. And the event of war and the activities of all forms of militarism feed off this affective nature, exploiting their transfigurative powers. Coupled with the effective ability of the technical apparatus of the cinematic, war events on screen, I think, display the breadth of their dialectical effectiveness of the vernacular and the vernacular of their audience. And the large format cinematic narrative film remains one of the most effective vehicles for this dialectical spiral that Deleuze talks about, into a dialectical spiral into the emotive capacity of a particular war aesthetic. Now, in his two cinema books, Deleuze further explores the perception of events, singular and serial, that are found in the chaosmosis and the chaoticity of the world and the storytelling of the world. And he's interested to tabulate the qualities of these behavioural movements in the cinema. And what he looks to chart is an evolution of their ethics. He writes a civil philosophy or psychology of the cinema, I think. It's part politics and part ethics. And he brings to this a certain kind of behavioural study of the cinema that we can apply to thinking about war on screen. Deleuze further reminds us in his cinema books of the nature of the technologically expanded relationship between image and thought. And it's both imminent and productive of a range of spiritual autonomy. The cinematic consciousness created by technologies of the 20th century produce quite a ritualized metaphysics of being, which Deleuze describes in terms of three different types of sublime movements: dynamic, dialectic, and mathematical. And although these sublimes are drawn directly from Kant's universalist aesthetics, Deleuze very clearly draws out the singular instances of this universal. Singular instances of the specific sublimes of the cinema. And from these 20th century cinematic sublimes, we've found that new screen technologies have enabled new conditions of perceptions of war events to such a degree that we understand that a vernacular fascism organises most screen events. In textual terms, this reign is perhaps easier to pin down, for example, when the dialectic sublimes invoked by such tactics or the terms such as shock and awe were moved out of the Kantian noosphere into the military doctrine that invaded Iraq and began the destruction of Baghdad in 2003 and straight onto the Sony PlayStation screen, or the disturbing ways in which Deleuze and Guattari's theorisation of smooth and striated spaces have been utilised by military strategists. No less obvious but of a different nature is the logic of the metaphysics of images that negate the future of a collective humanity and in whose aesthetics we continually participate and to maintain fascist ideologies and ontologies. Of course, as spectators, we no longer recoil at the immensity of the spectrum of militaristic power and all of its products, both visible and invisible. The mediation of conflicts in and around the Persian Gulf Wars of the last, particularly since 1991 when we saw those spectacular Green Knight visions, have given rise to another kind of war cinema, a cinema that stretches beyond the post-depictions of past wars, post-Gulf Wars. It's a war method that's significantly altered, and this material strategic shift in the image operation has necessarily also altered course. So embedded in this kind of media, our critical ability to embody any other but ourselves is denied, because of this militarised screen consciousness that we all now hold. It's a movement of perceptual ethnic differences. It's not a question of making sense of what we're seeing on the screen, because we know that the sense of any setting or system is a predetermined structure. For example, in the current Iraq war, in made-in-military zone videos of the conflict, shot for the most part by soldiers themselves, journalists, mercenaries, a handful of state-sponsored war artists, they're all generally non-trained filmmakers. We expect to encounter a certain amateur aesthetic, but what we get instead is a pathology of militarised movement, Nothing is held back. The war on screen expends all of its energy in the pursuit of militaristic events. And it's through the style of actions forming a diverse range of space events, drawing up and situating into a territorially claimed place-time. This is the storytelling, perpetual storytelling. Now, when we approach film, whether as participant, spectator, creator, critic, we quickly piece together fragments from life. We give form, we make form, however disparate or complementary, to create a whole, perhaps a filmic world, in order to make sense. But more often than not, we're trying to make patterns where none exist in reality, under this anthropophagic system of infinite consumptive practices. And the war film stages the breakdown of humanity into this distributive utility of the components of militarism, community, soldiers, transport, munition, destruction, death, wasteland, struggle, renewal, and so on. All of the associated neurological after effects that you would expect to happen to the human attitude from participating in this kind of events. The reality of war is that as an event, it means that in 5 minutes you could become a piece of meat, a pile of ash, an amputee, a spent bullet cartridge, and so on. So along those lines of thinking about what the war medium is and its dispersal of the habeas corpus to the militarism of capitalism, the diffusion of elements that might comprise any event incident becomes apparent. When the systems of this operation are condensed into screen time, the episodic conditions of the diffuse movements of the component human economic rituals of warfare become politicized through their aesthetics of style, structure, and relations. We can begin to see them. Technology, as an example of the cinematic screen, made it obvious to 20th century viewers that sensory motor function does not, despite its apparent logic, provide a motor extension or extensiveness to that sensory motor nature. Rather, what tends to happen through the complexities of the construction of the moving image, which Deleuze refers to as the process of, quote, weaving a network of non-localizable relations, unquote, is the transformation of perception of activities for the construction of political territories, caused by the introduction of an infinite number of sensory vectors, sound, music, and so on, engendering a continuum of the whole or the possibilities of any thinking about any kind of intellectual totality. Now, the nationalist structure of films concerning wars is addressed by Deleuze in terms of a Foucauldian biopolitics that performs a mutable genre of political differentiation. The films that do this best, according to Deleuze's aesthetic criteria of that particular operation, are the films that perform, quote, a psychomechanics of their cinematic perception. In this, Deleuze cites Pasolini's insights about the modern cinema, the freedom to be gained through a free indirect discourse, where there's a demonstration, not a metaphor, of the thought of the self-affecting cinema form. Goddard's determination of thought and choice of the cinema form is to be found in the interstitial, what Deleuze describes as the old associative agitprop one might find in the dialectic sublimes of Eisenstein's montages, as in his films October or Strike, where you've got montaged objects of worship and fetish, the state and vernacular icons of a city. These are all variously described by Deleuze as the point cut, a slip, the relinkage of independent images, the screen itself as abstract or eidetic, black or white, and they all perform a site for an axis of thought to occur. It's at these junctures, intensive moments, vectorial moments. This is where Deleuze says a cerebral process occurs, a flickering brain which relinks or creates loops. This is cinema. So just as we can teach children the rudiments of geometry by differentiating between the scales, dimensions and proportions of space, by measuring things with a length of string that could be knotted or stretched, these intensive moments within and of time, such as vectors, also provide us with tools to access and survey the properties of screen space. In fact, Deleuze likens these situations, vectorial situations, to a length of knotted rope, as indicated by the economies of some of his favourite directors, the Western directors Sam Peckinpah, Anthony Mann and Delma Davies. And their genre films perform a plurality of Wests, like the Western, like Goddard's pluralities of war, their totalities that comprise these broken strokes, genetic signs, heterogeneous critical instances. they're elements that jump from one another, and they create connections indirectly, creating totalities like the length of a knotted rope, twisting at each take and at each action and each event. So it's to this sense of thinking through connections, like the knotted rope, that Deleuze then complicates the whole by asking us to consider the temporal mode or style of the film in question, creating a film that covers the dimensions of its world through the creation of this kind of skeletal space. Often involves a fracturing of chronological time and the cinematic presentations of an extensive perception of the whole of the situation. And of course, we just saw that in Godard's war sequence in Notre Musique. So we're drawn into this differential vertigo of a fascist screen nomos, and I'm using nomos in the sense of the old sense of the word, meaning the law, and as Deleuze and Guattari use it in terms of a groundless potential site for utilisation. It can be both creative and destructive. Now, many readers of Deleuze have, of course, noted this aspect of the process of neurological modification, which Deleuze describes in the cinema books. Developing from this nomos of the cinema as a site of distribution of elements to be associated according to the determining laws of jurisprudence, we find that the event is nesting in the vertigo of spacing, that flickering brain. Cinematographic consciousness is the event. In other words, in the display of a cinema form, powers of modification occur not only in the conditions on the screen, but also in the neurological dimensions of the modification of consciousness. This is, again to use John Prodevy's apt phrase, a political physics. And it's in this sense of a differential metaphysics, the activity of the cinema itself, that Deleuze describes the cinematic event. So thus the temporal modality of the event describes a breadth of relations with which we can chart the genesis of different states of being. So I want to now turn to this apparent paradox of the intensive site of the metaphysical activity of the cinema form through the movement of the war event on screen as a form of action image. Deleuze describes the action image with a number of physical terms, including, quote, the reaction of the centre to the set as an ensemble, unquote. And this sense of reaction is Nietzschean. Deleuze is looking at the movement of forces, the acts and actions of qualities, things that produce conditions and situations that produce things in relation to a subject. The action image is thus like a spiral, he will conclude at the end of his second cinema book. Now, following this, the cinematic event is a consideration of the perception of movement from situation to modification by an action. So Deleuze comes to understand the movement of the cinema as a political physics through a number of ways, Bergson, Merleau-Ponty, differential calculus, and so on. Further, he asks us to look at the temporal intensities of the event, and I think he looks at these under a Nietzschean utilisation of the physical nomos of Apollo and Dionysius. Nietzsche accounts for the activities and actions of these ancient Greek gods in his book, The Birth of Tragedy, and it's also a metaphysics that a number of theorists have noted run right through Nietzsche's entire body of work. There's a double structure to the Nietzschean model of reciprocal relations produced through this aspect of the mythos, as a devise of a particular kind of political physics that I've just sketched out, which Deleuze draws on to talk about the two poles of oscillating possibilities for any event. So if we consider the war on screen, and by this I mean the war as reported by the media on television, and a war as simulated in film and television and on computer screens, this war screen articulates a critical aletheia in the Greek word meaning a truth or reality, an aesthetic place of Apollonian transformation where one can partake of the Dionysian pathetic intensities of a tragedy. So what Deleuze notes via Nietzsche's critical description of actions is our awareness of our aesthetic attribution of life in order to see life. The event is to make war. In the attribution of a state of becoming, a number of issues arise. In the infinitive of becoming, future becoming, or a present revision of a past, first we have the question of the a priori perception that a future arises, a destiny in the Nietzschean sense, or a socially expected occupation that we might take on, leading to a fulfillment of pathos. You know, I am a soldier, I am expected to kill people. This destiny. Second, in the production of and the representation of forces of the bodies, we can initially grasp how Deleuze's event is a dissolution of the Kantian dialectic of the synthesis of time and space. In terms of the screen, Deleuze considers the synthesis in terms of vision and sound. Sounds quite important. So third consideration, in the cinema too, Deleuze must address the issue of cinematic music as an action that operates upon perception, the results of which can vary according to the technical structure of the screen. As a form of mythos, sound can exist as stasis, Deleuze finds, eternal moments of the interval, or it can become part of the movement image if it's not used as a critical device. Again, Nietzsche's consideration of the physics of the ground of being, explored in The Birth of Tragedy, makes Deleuze reconsider how he approaches film music against a correspondence with an image. The visual image comes from Apollo, who caused it to move according to a measure and makes it represent the whole indirectly, mediately, through the intermediary of lyric poetry or drama, he writes. Leaving these brief points aside for the moment, which of course are by no means exhaustive, we can see that Deleuze's affinity with the Nietzschean treatment of physical conditions contribute to the cognizance of situation. This is a Nietzschean psychomechanics of war. Each of these victorial moments on screen may be considered to be events in terms of the critical reality, the aletheia, that they enact. War films are generally literally constructed around what are deemed to be significant historical events. The lead-in and then effective contact and post-events permeate throughout their diegetic milieu, and they form a kind of contract, an admission to the event. Ex post facto, they hold some physical epistemology. The event is what the cinematic screen enables us to perceive, pure duration, forces in engendering duration, a sense of the consolidating passage of time, however fleeting or static. The event is the whole physical moving cinema in its entirety. As Tom Conley puts it, quote, an event is not what takes place or is framed by a cause, an effect, or what would have the appearance of a datum. Deleuze takes the example, a man is crushed. It is rather what is endowed with duration, unquote. Now, the Second World War is a marker that's often used, invoked to describe the distinction between Deleuze's cinema books when I'm looking at how they're operating. But again, in terms of this separation lie the components of the element of the war that he invokes. So we can observe that these books are separated by extensive vectors, ones that are separated by movement, the second separated by time. And this break is often historically described in terms of key moments in cinematic history, such as the advent of Italian neorealism or the New Wave movement of the 60s. But actually, it's less of an epistemic separation than an expression of the aesthetic and stylistic poles of the same event. Now, Deleuze, of course, invokes the notion of a pole quite frequently in his cinema books, and he uses this as a signal for this physics, this movement, a caesura reversal that ensures that there are no distinctive limits for image to be thought. Rather, what he does in the cinema books is adopt the method that he laid out in Difference and Repetition in order to speak of the thinking of difference as, quote, the state in which one can speak of determination as such, unquote. The cinema books continue Deleuze's Kantian critique against determining values espoused in Cartesian cognitive and perceptual implications that support the determination of I think and assumptions of being. Again, I would argue that's an a priori destiny that we're thinking about. Now, this all sounds a little bit bleak, but Deleuze does argue for redemption for the image. He says that we can take it out of this fascist cycle. And he argues for this redemption by utilising those very tactics that have seen the reduction of the format of violence to what Paul Virilio called the microphysical, as in the microphysical of the television screen. We reduce these huge events to this tiny thing. Redemption, writes Deleuze in the conclusion to Cinema 2, is, quote, an art beyond knowledge, and it is also creation beyond information. However, against fascist co-option, redemption of the image does exist for Deleuze by way of a critical naming of the event, extensive, intensive, or prehensive moments and movements which produce divergent series, including different time series. Under the influence of film's phenomenological aesthetic, Deleuze repeats this chorus for a kind of a surf physiology that he argues for again and again. In Difference and Repetition, he says, we perceive the thing minus that which does not interest us as a function of our needs, unquote. So by interest or need, we maintain an event, whether it's a war. And war is an event that our society maintains because of its affective qualities. Invocation of this state, it's a desirable state, it can cause an affective diaphora, a transportation into a prehensive aesthetic of the war event. After perception, according to Deleuze, we will fill out the conjunction is filled by a constitutive affect of the war, which propels perception into action. It's this, the eternal return. And so thinking about this affect, we must consider how affect plays a critical elemental role at the microscopic level for a war event. It's an atomic element required for the relational movement of this screen composition. Affect in this sense is the decentered centre necessarily for the eternal return that Deleuze will define via Klosowski. This effect does not define or express an order, but it becomes, for Deleuze's cinematographic perception, a necessary phenomenological aesthetic that drives perception into action, in particular psychological terms. Okay. All right, of course, cinematographic perception is not the same as phenomenology, and Deleuze will argue against that, because phenomenology argues for a natural perception, which means that movement's still related to specific poses or fixed points of apperception. Deleuze isn't arguing for that at all. Okay, so just to conclude, thinking about these militaristic activities that we're surrounded by, the boundaries of the screen genre are ever-expanding. Internet trophy killing and digital films that are posted on the internet, soldiers' own digital diaries of current conflicts, these all capture the nature of conflict, contemporary conflict, far in advance of commercially distributed feature films. However, war films of all forms are collectively indicative of the ways in which cultural forms, including entertainment, government, educational and financial industries, contribute to this evolution and parsing of historical events in relation to and retrospectively targeted recognition by different histories, and in relation to political formulations and the manipulation of subjects of economic imperatives, desires of the past and the future, and so on. Different controls over economies of agriculture, medicine, migration flows. These all result in mutations of societies and cultures because of these politically driven aesthetic imperatives. People bound within war events are redetermined as subjects born of a particular place, a culture and politics. They're dispersed, they're destroyed, they're stolen. Attention to the modes of effect on screen highlights these redistributive dimensions of war, how effective actions produce these axes of transformative topologies, of political geographies, the elastic geography, and elastic cultural consciousness ever expanding in Bergsonian terms. So this cinematographic event is a perceptual activity. It's a process of infinitive actions, perpetually in transformation, atomistic sensations congealing as sensorial forms, mashed, differentiated, dispersed, and re-needed. The war event on screen has engendered this dissimulation of the meanings of war. It's a process that's transformed all of us into a zombie herd of common people directed into this perceptual ground. Thanks. And you can tell I just watched 28 Days Later when I wrote that. All right, I'm not suggesting we're all zombie herd, but... Okay, thank you.